Introduction. Acoustic phonetics is the study of the physical features of speech sounds, in particular those that are linguistically relevant and can be detected by the human ear and the medium in which they travel. All sounds are produced by movement of molecules, typically of air. They move in a vibrating-like fashion, creating periods of rarefaction, farther apart, and compression, closer together, between molecules. Together, one rarefaction and one compression of air molecules make up a cycle. As vibrations move through the air, they create many cycles that, as a whole, can be referred to as a wave. The speed of the vibrations, compression plus rarefaction, is called the frequency and is a very common measure of sound. The unit of measurement for frequency is hertz, hertz, and 1 hertz is equal to 1 cycle per second. Humans are typically able to detect sound waves with frequencies of 20,000 hertz traveling through air. Acoustic phonetics uses the frequencies of these sound waves to precisely analyze speech. By combining the knowledge of articulatory phonetics and with use of a spectrograph, researchers have been able to pinpoint exact values and acoustic characteristics and use them to define particular vowels and consonants. For this reason, acoustic phonetics is especially important when considering vowels, as they are more difficult to define within the realms of articulatory phonetics. See the chapter on articulatory phonetics for more information. The logistics of how this is done is extremely interesting and will be explained below, along with the unique characteristics of common American English speech sounds. I will begin by physically describing speech sounds, jump to speech sounds, move on to explain the spectrograph and spectrogram, the spectrograph, and finalize the chapter with information on how to read the spectrogram and use it to identify particular speech sounds, reading a spectrogram. It is valuable to note that the information below may not apply to all languages, as speech sounds and even the way of producing identical speech sounds can differ between languages. Speech sounds physically disrupting the placement of air molecules or molecules of another medium that sound can travel in produces sound, but acoustic phonetics is concerned only with speech sounds. To produce speech sounds, we push air from the lungs through the glottis, which makes the vocal cords vibrate. These vibrations occur in a pulse-like manner, pushing air out of the mouth or nose and displacing air with each pulse. The variations in air pressure due to these pulses can be represented as a waveform, which is what acoustic phonetics uses to characterize speech sounds. While articulatory phonetics, see this wiki page for more information, defines speech sounds using manner place of articulation, acoustic phonetics looks at the properties of the sound waves produced and links them to articulatory characteristics. This will be better explained in the section reading a spectrogram. Jump to it. What is considered linguistically relevant? There are many possible speech sounds that can be used in a language, but not every sound is used in every language, and the same sounds can be used in different ways, depending on the language or dialect. In the latter case, acoustic phonetic properties of a word can change from language to language, and even dialect to dialect. For example, the acoustic characteristics at the end of the word checker would differ in British English compared to American English. The speech sounds actually used in a particular language are considered relevant, while any others are not considered when studying acoustic phonetics of that language. An example of a sound not heard in English but used in other languages are clicks, such as the post-alveolar click. Press play below to hear what a click sounds like. In this example, is being spoken with A in the sequence ah. Ah. There are also sounds that can be made by the vocal tract, like coughs and burps, that are not considered relevant speech sounds in any language. To sum up, the relevance of a speech sound depends on the language you are interested in, and as a general rule, acoustic phonetics looks at the speech sounds meaningfully produced within a language. Some of the major components of speech sounds are described below. Characteristics of speech sounds. Speech sounds can be classed as either sonorants or obstruents. Sonorants include nasal stops, approximants and vowels, and have even, periodic waveforms that compress air molecules at regular, repeating intervals. Oral stops, affricates and fricatives are obstruents and display uneven, aperiodic waveforms. To produce nasals, the velum is lowered and air flows through the nasal cavity, e.g. per m and n in man. Approximants occur when there is more constriction in airflow through the vocal tract compared to vowels, but less constriction than with consonants, e.g. glides, like y in yo or with in waffle. Vowels are produced when articulators are completely separated and air flows freely, without constriction, through the vocal tract. A, E, I, O, and U are all vowels in English and can make different sounds depending on the environment in which they are found, e.g. U in tuned and U in sun are pronounced differently. Frequency. The frequency of a wave refers to the number of times a waveform completes one full cycle within a second. It is measured in hertz, which is equal to the number of cycles per second. The thumbnail to the right is an example of a sinusoidal wave. The wavelength represents one cycle. You can see that the cycle contains two crests. One peak, where the wave is furthest above the baseline, or has the highest amplitude above the baseline, and one trough, where the wave is furthest below the baseline, or has the lowest amplitude from baseline. The wave begins to repeat itself after both crests have occurred. The crests correspond with rarefaction and compression of the molecules within the medium through which the sound is traveling. This repetition occurs in all periodic waves, but not aperiodic waves. Frequency is the more objective term for pitch, which can sometimes be quite subjective. The higher the frequency of a sound, the higher its pitch will be. The human ear can detect sound with frequencies between 20-20,000 Hz, but most speech sounds are within the range of 106,000 Hz. To put this into perspective, an average male would speak with a lower pitch, therefore his frequency would be towards the lower end of that spectrum, approximately 120 Hz on average. Calculating frequency. It is not always easy to calculate the frequency of waves, because not often is there a perfect ratio of one cycle per second. For this reason, there is a formula used to calculate frequencies. Frequency, hertz, equals number of cycles time, sec, in the image above, assuming that the horizontal axis represents time in seconds, we see that one cycle occurs in about 6.25 seconds. Using the formula for frequency, we can determine that this wave has a frequency of 0.16 Hz. Frequency, Hz, equals 1, number of cycles, 6.25, time in seconds, equals 0.16 Hz. This tells us that the pitch of this sound is extremely low. If you recall the range of perceptibility allowed by the human ear, this tone would not even be heard by humans. Intensity. The intensity of a sound wave is measured in decibels, and represents the power and loudness of the wave. Intensity is correlated with the amplitude of the wave, or how high above, compression, or below, rarefaction, the baseline the wave reaches in each cycle. In this case, amplitude is an objective measurement of loudness, which is a more subjective measure of sound. Humans can typically hear from 0 decibels to 120 decibels, at which point sound is painfully perceived. Loudness of sound can be affected by distance as well as the composition of the propagating medium. The more efficient the propagating medium, the louder the sound. For example, think about the difference in loudness between shouting in air versus shouting underwater. One practical use for this concept is soundproof rooms, which would be built using highly efficient materials to absorb as much noise as possible, decreasing both the loudness of a sound and its distance traveled. Timbre, also known as tone, refers to the shape pattern of the waveform. Each speech sound has a unique shape responsible for giving it a unique sound. That is, the timbre of a sound is what makes it possible for us to differentiate one sound from the next and combine different sounds to communicate different meanings using language. However, most speech sound waves are not as simplistic as the examples used above in the frequency section. In fact, the above examples would be a waveform of a pure tone, which is computer-generated, artificial, and does not occur in any natural sound. Rather, speech sounds are composed of multiple sinusoidal waves, shown on top in the image below, that combine to create a more complex wave, characteristic to the specific sound, shown on bottom. Although the bottom waveform looks quite complicated, it is often broken down into its various sinusoidal wave components, i.e. the top waves, which vary in frequency and amplitude, for analysis. This is typically done on a computer using Fourier analysis, http://n.wikipedia.org/wiki/Fourier_analysis for more information. Each individual sinusoidal wave is called a harmonic. When looking at speech sounds, the focus is mainly on the first four harmonics. The intensity decreases from the first harmonic up, so that the lowest harmonic is the loudest, and as you move to a higher harmonic they get quieter. The frequency increases by multiples of the first harmonic, otherwise known as the fundamental frequency, pho. The frequency of the sound wave as a whole is equal to the fundamental frequency, or the frequency of the lowest, first, harmonic. The complex shape of the waveform is due to the shape of the vocal tract when producing sounds, which reinforces some frequencies more than others. Since we make different shapes with the vocal tract to produce specific sounds, it makes sense for the waveform to change as the vocal tract changes to create each unique sound. Quality. It is due to quality of sound that we can differentiate one musical instrument from another, or likewise one voice from another when dealing with speech. The quality of a sound depends on the shape and material of the propagating and closing media. Using music as an example, the trumpet, a brass instrument, sounds different compared clarinet, a wooden instrument, or the vocal tract, as used by singers, but the trombone, another brass instrument, has a similar sound. Thus, the material of the apparatus can create a distinct sound class that can be further divided by shape. Different shapes lead to different harmonics. We learned that the fundamental frequency underlies the harmonics of a sound and provides the basic frequency of a sound. Thus, different harmonics, caused by different apparatus shapes, create different sounds. These changes are considered to be changes in quality. Introduction: Acoustic phonetics is the study of the physical features of speech sounds, in particular those that are linguistically relevant and can be detected by the human ear and the medium in which they travel. All sounds are produced by movement of molecules, typically of air. They move in a vibrating-like fashion, creating periods of rarefaction, farther apart, and compression, closer together, between molecules. Together, one rarefaction and one compression of air molecules make up a cycle. As vibrations move through the air, they create many cycles that, as a whole, can be referred to as a wave. The speed of the vibrations, compression plus rarefaction, is called the frequency and is a very common measure of sound. The unit of measurement for frequency is hertz, hertz, and 1 hertz is equal to 1 cycle per second. Humans are typically able to detect sound waves with frequencies of 20,000 hertz traveling through air. Acoustic phonetics uses the frequencies of these sound waves to precisely analyze speech. By combining the knowledge of articulatory phonetics and with use of a spectrograph, researchers have been able to pinpoint exact values and acoustic characteristics and use them to define particular vowels and consonants. For this reason, acoustic phonetics is especially important when considering vowels, as they are more difficult to define within the realms of articulatory phonetics. See the chapter on articulatory phonetics for more information. The logistics of how this is done is extremely interesting and will be explained below, along with the unique characteristics of common American English speech sounds. I will begin by physically describing speech sounds, jump to speech sounds, move on to explain the spectrograph and spectrogram, the spectrograph, and finalize the chapter with information on how to read the spectrogram and use it to identify particular speech sounds, reading a spectrogram. It is valuable to note that the information below may not apply to all languages, as speech sounds, and even the way of producing identical speech sounds can differ between languages. Speech sounds physically disrupting the placement of air molecules, or molecules of another medium that sound can travel in, produces sound, but acoustic phonetics is concerned only with speech sounds. To produce speech sounds, we push air from the lungs through the glottis, which makes the vocal cords vibrate. These vibrations occur in a pulse-like manner, pushing air out of the mouth or nose and displacing air with each pulse. The variations in air pressure due to these pulses can be represented as a waveform, which is what acoustic phonetics uses to characterize speech sounds. While articulatory phonetics, see this wiki page for more information, defines speech sounds using manner place of articulation, acoustic phonetics looks at the properties of the sound waves produced and links them to articulatory characteristics. This will be better explained in the section reading a spectrogram. Jump to it. What is considered linguistically relevant? There are many possible speech sounds that can be used in a language, but not every sound is used in every language, and the same sounds can be used in different ways, depending on the language or dialect. In the latter case, acoustic phonetic properties of a word can change from language to language, and even dialect to dialect. For example, the acoustic characteristics at the end of the word checker would differ in British English compared to American English. The speech sounds actually used in a particular language are considered relevant, while any others are not considered when studying acoustic phonetics of that language. An example of a sound not heard in English but used in other languages are clicks, such as the post-alveolar click. Press play below to hear what a click sounds like. In this example, is being spoken with A in the sequence ah. Ah. There are also sounds that can be made by the vocal tract, like coughs and burps, that are not considered relevant speech sounds in any language. To sum up, the relevance of a speech sound depends on the language you are interested in, and as a general rule, acoustic phonetics looks at the speech sounds meaningfully produced within a language. Some of the major components of speech sounds are described below. Characteristics of speech sounds. Speech sounds can be classed as either sonorants or obstruents. Sonorants include nasal stops, approximants and vowels, and have even, periodic waveforms that compress air molecules at regular, repeating intervals. Oral stops, affricates and fricatives are obstruents and display uneven, aperiodic waveforms. To produce nasals, the velum is lowered, and air flows through the nasal cavity, e.g. per m and n in man. Approximants occur when there is more constriction in airflow through the vocal tract compared to vowels, but less constriction than with consonants, e.g. glides, like y in yo or with in waffle. Vowels are produced when articulators are completely separated and air flows freely, without constriction, through the vocal tract. A, E, I, O, and U are all vowels in English and can make different sounds depending on the environment in which they are found, e.g. U in tuned and U in sun are pronounced differently. Frequency: the frequency of a wave refers to the number of times a waveform completes one full cycle within a second. It is measured in hertz, which is equal to the number of cycles per second. The thumbnail to the right is an example of a sinusoidal wave. The wavelength represents one cycle. You can see that the cycle contains two crests. One peak, where the wave is furthest above the baseline, or has the highest amplitude above the baseline, and one trough, where the wave is furthest below the baseline, or has the lowest amplitude from baseline. The wave begins to repeat itself after both crests have occurred. The crests correspond with rarefaction and compression of the molecules within the medium through which the sound is traveling. This repetition occurs in all periodic waves, but not aperiodic waves. Frequency is the more objective term for pitch, which can sometimes be quite subjective. The higher the frequency of a sound, the higher its pitch will be. The human ear can detect sound with frequencies between 20-20,000 Hz, but most speech sounds are within the range of 106,000 Hz. To put this into perspective, an average male would speak with a lower pitch, therefore his frequency would be towards the lower end of that spectrum, approximately 120 Hz on average. Calculating frequency: it is not always easy to calculate the frequency of waves, because not often is there a perfect ratio of one cycle per second. For this reason, there is a formula used to calculate frequencies: frequency, hertz, equals number of cycles time, sec, in the image above. Assuming that the horizontal axis represents time in seconds, we see that one cycle occurs in about 6.25 seconds. Using the formula for frequency, we can determine that this wave has a frequency of 0.16 Hz frequency, hertz, equals 1, number of cycles, 6.25, time in seconds, equals 0.16 Hz. This tells us that the pitch of this sound is extremely low. If you recall the range of perceptibility allowed by the human ear, this tone would not even be heard by humans. Intensity: the intensity of a sound wave is measured in decibels, and represents the power and loudness of the wave. Intensity is correlated with the amplitude of the wave, or how high above, compression, or below, rarefaction, the baseline the wave reaches in each cycle. In this case, amplitude is an objective measurement of loudness, which is a more subjective measure of sound. Humans can typically hear from 0 decibels to 120 decibels, at which point sound is painfully perceived. Loudness of sound can be affected by distance as well as the composition of the propagating medium. The more efficient the propagating medium, the louder the sound. For example, think about the difference in loudness between shouting in air versus shouting underwater. One practical use for this concept is soundproof rooms, which would be built using highly efficient materials to absorb as much noise as possible, decreasing both the loudness of a sound and its distance traveled. Timbre, also known as tone, refers to the shape pattern of the waveform. Each speech sound has a unique shape responsible for giving it a unique sound. That is, the timbre of a sound is what makes it possible for us to differentiate one sound from the next and combine different sounds to communicate different meanings using language. However, most speech sound waves are not as simplistic as the examples used above in the frequency section. In fact, the above examples would be a waveform of a pure tone, which is computer-generated, artificial, and does not occur in any natural sound. Rather, speech sounds are composed of multiple sinusoidal waves, shown on top in the image below, that combine to create a more complex wave, characteristic to the specific sound, shown on bottom. Although the bottom waveform looks quite complicated, it is often broken down into its various sinusoidal wave components, i.e. the top waves, which vary in frequency and amplitude, for analysis. This is typically done on a computer using Fourier analysis, http://n.wikipedia.org/wiki/Fourier_analysis for more information. Each individual sinusoidal wave is called a harmonic. When looking at speech sounds, the focus is mainly on the first four harmonics. The intensity decreases from the first harmonic up, so that the lowest harmonic is the loudest, and as you move to a higher harmonic they get quieter. The frequency increases by multiples of the first harmonic, otherwise known as the fundamental frequency, pho. The frequency of the sound wave as a whole is equal to the fundamental frequency, or the frequency of the lowest, first, harmonic. The complex shape of the waveform is due to the shape of the vocal tract when producing sounds, which reinforces some frequencies more than others. Since we make different shapes with the vocal tract to produce specific sounds, it makes sense for the waveform to change as the vocal tract changes to create each unique sound. Quality: it is due to quality of sound that we can differentiate one musical instrument from another, or likewise one voice from another when dealing with speech. The quality of a sound depends on the shape and material of the propagating and closing media. Using music as an example, the trumpet, a brass instrument, sounds different compared to clarinet, a wooden instrument, or the vocal tract, as used by singers, but the trombone, another brass instrument, has a similar sound. Thus, the material of the apparatus can create a distinct sound class that can be further divided by shape. Different shapes lead to different harmonics. We learned that the fundamental frequency underlies the harmonics of a sound and provides the basic frequency of a sound. Thus, different harmonics, caused by different apparatus shapes, create different sounds. These changes are considered to be changes in quality.